It has a very long biography. Okay, so we should skip this? Okay, good.
People can look Google me.
Okay, you can Google her, Susan Herman, but do know that she is president of the American Civil Liberties Union since October 2008. Also, chair of the Centennial Professor of Law at Brooklyn Law School. And, okay, I invited her here because we just need to hear from you. We need to hear what the ACLU is doing. I heard you at Barnard a few months ago, and it was just, and one of the questions that you were asked was, what are you doing with all that money? So we want to hear that for sure. But I also just wanted to connect us as ethical culturists to the ACLU, because one of the things that we mentioned is that we co-founded the ACLU. And I noticed that there's not nearly enough of that on your website. So I just want to remind you that Roger Baldwin knew Felix Adler. His mother knew Felix Adler very well. Actually, it was his aunt who knew Felix Adler very well, when they started the National Civil Liberties Bureau, and Felix Adler was on that. But also Jane Addams, who together with Anna Garland Spencer, one of our leaders, co-founded the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. So Jane Addams was a member of the Chicago Society, and was very one of the co-founders. But also, and now Jane Addams is mentioned, but John Lovejoy Elliott isn't. And that's a shame, because John Lovejoy Elliott is one of my favorite leaders. And he started, he was part of the Settlement House movement. He started Hudson Guild, that is still very active, and the Elliott houses are there. And I just want to read to you something that that Baldwin said about John Lovejoy Elliott. So let's see, so Roger Baldwin said that Elliott is one of the most faithful men on the directing committee and one of the standouts, a man who never failed us. He took an active part in the defense of conscientious objectors and the rights of freedom of speech. So just a little hint to please include my favorite John Lovejoy Elliott, because I think he's one of our favorites as well. Unlike our very austere founder, Felix Adler, Elliott loved to have children climb up in his lap and loved the hurly-burly boys down in Chelsea, boys down the Hudson Guild. But I want to ask you, how has things been for you since the election? Because I know that you have, certainly I have contributed more, I know a lot of people here have, and I know on my Facebook timeline, I'm always putting how many days it's been since that ruling in San Diego. So how has life been for you and the ACLU since the election?
Well, a great question. That's very much my present. And I also am giving more these days, both in time and everything else, because there's so much to do. But I think I first wanted to kind of go back to the history. So before I came here to speak the first time, I was very interested in some of the history you were talking about the connections between ethical culture and the founders of the ACLU. So if you want there to be more about that on our website, may I invite you or whoever else wants to do a blog piece?
Absolutely.
Wouldn't that be interesting?
Yes.
To kind of talk. So among the founders who we talk about, I think, you know, Bonita was using the word interconnected. Mm-hmm. And to me, it's not just the connections between the ACLU and ethical culture, but the connections across the board.
Yes.
So you probably know the ACLU works in 14 different areas of civil rights and civil liberties. So we do, you know, racial justice and women's rights and LGBT rights and due process, and we're against mass incarceration, and we do immigrants' rights and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Maybe you cover the waterfront there. And that's been so since 1920. So you were sort of identifying some of the people. Mm-hmm. And certainly, you know, Roger Baldwin was himself a conscientious objector. He spent a year in prison rather than the things that he disagreed with. And the ACLU actually grew out of the Americans Against Americans United Against Militarization. And they started out defending COs and then decided in 1920 that there needed to be an organization defending free speech, because a lot of the people during World War I who spoke out against the war or against the draft or against the form of government were prosecuted and locked up. They were convicted of sedition. So yeah, that was one stream that was going into this. Another was, if you think about 1920 and a couple of the people you're talking about, including Jane Addams, 1920 was when women finally got the vote. Mm-hmm. So what we tend to focus on in our website is not just Roger Baldwin, who everyone thinks of, but Baldwin's co-founder, mm-hmm. Crystal Eastman,
yes,
who
is
a woman lawyer, who was with Roger at, the mm-hmm. representing COs. And had she not become ill, she would have been our first executive director. Mm-hmm. They were very much internationalists. And the other thing I find fascinating is, there were all these people who were coming out of the battle for suffrage. They were internationalists. Mm-hmm. They believed in peace. There were a lot of themes. But I think their basic idea was about other people's mm-hmm. rights. It wasn't just about me. The women had just been through that. They had gotten their right to vote. And they wanted to defend not only the people who were labor organizers and COs, but everybody who had any concerns about free speech or their freedom of religion or due process, et cetera. So in addition to you're mentioning Jane Addams, we had other social workers
yes.
who were founders, like Jeanette Rankin, who was the first woman in Congress, Helen Keller, who mm-hmm. was one of our founders. So we tend to stress, especially with our 100th anniversary about to come up, mm-hmm. we just tend to stress a lot of the women
yes.
who were involved
and
in the
Schneiderman
founders.
As well, so
exactly.
the shirtwaist fire.
Exactly, they're amazing, and it's yes. an amazing collection yep. of people. But what I find moving, and this is sort of getting me to today and what we do, to me, there are so many great organizations that do great work in one area, racial justice or LGBT rights or whatever they do. And what's so special to me about the ACLU, and the reason that this is where I spend my time, is that we connect the dots. Mm-hmm. It's what Benita was saying. If I think that I should have the right to be treated equally and to exercise my chosen religion and say what I think, even if it's a dissenting point of view, then I have to be willing to protect your right mm-hmm. to do that also, even if your religion or your beliefs or your situation in life is different. So to me, all the areas go together, and that's what's so important. But that's what's keeping us so busy these days, because we work in 14 areas of civil rights and civil liberties, and so does the Trump administration.
Yes.
So what Anne was saying is that since the election, our membership has quadrupled. We're now 1.8 million members. The challenges are really severe. But I think people are realizing that things that we've taken for granted, we can't really take for granted. And I'll tell you two quotes, people who kind of joined up after the election. One person said, without the ACLU, I would have no hope.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a lot about hope, as you were saying, hoping that we're going to not lose our soul. And the other note that I loved was to say, one person who said, thank God for the ACLU, without you, we'd have no government. And that's what it feels like. It feels like we're the ones right now who are being called upon to preserve our fundamental values.
Another thing, one of the things that you mentioned at Barnier about changing your strategy, because you've quadrupled, you've also invited members to be more engaged.
Yes.
And so you've got more things on the ground now where people can actually join. So it used to be, I don't want to say passive because you were always active. But sort of clients would come to you, but you're much more engaged, not only on the ground in the chapters, but also later there, going to Guatemala and actually finding the parents there. So this level of engagement is exponential.
I think that's certainly true, and for quite a number of reasons, partially because we do have more resources, so we're able to broaden our responses as opposed to just bringing a few lawsuits. Mm-hmm. People think of the ACLU as just lawyers and litigation. Mm-hmm. But we do a lot more than that. As Anne was saying, we have affiliates in every state, which means that we can really decide where you start the battle for something and be strategic about that. So I think recently what we've had to do is to really kind of change our ground game in a couple of different ways. What Anne was saying, so it used to be that when people would say, okay, I'm a member of the ACLU, I give you money, but isn't there something more active I can do to help more? And he would say, give us more money. And I know we can do more. But what we're doing now is we're really including volunteers as well. So if you haven't seen, we have this program called People Power, and that could be all of you if you're already members or if you're not, you can actually help. So People Power has had two different initiatives so far. The first one was something that we called Freedom Cities. And what we did was our staff drafted 9 model ordinances for towns and cities. About two things. The first was about how to become a sanctuary city. You all know the idea. So you all know probably that a sanctuary city doesn't mean you can really provide sanctuary, because New York City cannot keep ICE out. If the federal agents want to come arrest people in New York City, they can, because there's a supremacy clause in the Constitution. But what we can do is we can decline to help them. We can decline to have the NYPD locate people and arrest them or turn them over, you know, et cetera. So a lot of people are very confused by this. A lot of cities aren't sure what they have to do and what they have to agree to help with, where they have to cooperate, where they have space not to. So we drafted these 9 model ordinances about being a sanctuary city, what we call a freedom city, because it's not really sanctuary, and also about police misconduct. And then we had volunteers who listened to an hour launch program about, you know, your rights while demonstrating and different things that were mutual background and about the law itself. And then groups of volunteers would gather in house parties to watch this, and then they would get together and go to their local chief of police or city council or whoever and ask them to adopt the ordinances. And that was incredibly successful. So, you know, we don't have enough staff to do all of that. But for example, Phoenix, Arizona adopted the ordinances. You know, volunteers went and asked people to do it. And they, you know, they looked at it, they thought it was a good idea. So I think it's a great kind of partnership between the professionals who can say, we vetted this ordinance and we know that this is what's right. This is what localities can do. But we need people on the ground to go and make that happen, because we don't have enough people to go to every city council and every town board. So the second initiative that we have now, that this time of year you might be very interested in, is about voting rights. Mm-hmm. And here we have a state-specific plan for every state. So in New York, do you think we're so great? We're not Mississippi. The voter turnout in New York is extremely low. We're down there with Mississippi. We're among the lowest turnout states. And there are reasons for that in the law. One is that New York has no early voting. Another is that you all know you had to register about 25 days before the election. What's that about? You know, we could change that. You were not so good at disabled people voting. Mm-hmm. You know, can you vote if you're blind, things like that. So if you looked at the People Power website, we have a specific program of fixes that we asked from the legislature. And, you know, Governor Cuomo was with this. You know, these are things that could happen to make New York better. And then we have, you know, parallel things going on in many other states. Where you've read about the nonsense that's going on in Georgia and other places. Okay, so, you know, every single state, we're trying to push back. So that's one way that Anne is saying that we really are trying to, we're trying to do community organizing in addition to just law. But let me mention the second thing too, which is also a very different thing for us. We used to have, our main base is in New York, and then we have the affiliates all over the country. But our Washington office used to be called the Washington Legislative Office, and we had a director there who was mostly looking at what Congress was doing, proposing legislation and all. When we replaced the person who left that position, we hired somebody who we call instead our National Political Director. Now, we are nonpartisan, as you have to be, first of all, if you're, you know, a not-for-profit organization, but that also is part of who we are. You were about principles, not about particular parties or candidates. But what we're trying to do now is to be much more strategic about what we're pushing. So our political director is somebody who came from politics, and he's able to look around the country and really figure out, okay, so if what we're trying to do is to do something about mass incarceration or about voting rights, what states are good places mm-hmm. to start? So to give you a few examples, and this is also an answering the question of how are we using the money. Right. Part of it we're using to pay legal earns, you know, travel down to Guatemala mm-hmm. to reunite the parents and children. But part of it we are using for a ballot initiative in Florida, which we're co-sponsoring, which would get rid of felon disenfranchisement for most people in Florida who can't vote. Now, you may know that there are 1.4 million people in Florida who can't vote because they were once convicted of a felony. And Florida is one of only 4 states that does that. But it's been very difficult to change that because it's embedded in the Florida Constitution. And when you look at where that came from, it came from Reconstruction. It came from Florida trying to keep the vote white. It's perfectly clear what's going on. You use your racist criminal justice system mm-hmm. to get African-American men convicted, and then they can't vote. Mm-hmm. And there are, you know, millions of African-American men in Florida who can't vote. Okay, so the legislature cannot change this. It's in the Constitution. Which means it has to be a ballot initiative. So we've been working on this with the League of Women Voters and other organizations. Let me tell you, I think the coalition, because I think this is interesting too. League of Women Voters, the Brennan Center, the Koch brothers. Okay, you know, the Koch brothers. They believe in redemption. They believe in second chances, and it's a place where we really try to have strange dead fellow alliances. You can't talk to them about, you know, there's racial disproportion here. That, you know, that's not their concern. But they're very much concerned with redemption and second chances and the religious aspect. Another co-sponsor, Ben and Jerry's. You know, these days a lot of people ask, well, what can corporations do? Should corporations be involved politically? I say yes. But it's incredibly expensive to run a ballot initiative. But this, you know, this is just a game changer in Florida, just letting people vote. It's also been shown that if people vote, the rate of recidivism goes down. They're civically engaged.
Because they're engaged, right.
Exactly.
That's brilliant. You know, and it just reminds me again, bringing it back to ethical culture, putting ethics at the center, that's the common ground. So you found the common ground with the Koch brothers, who many liberals tend to demonize. Mm-hmm. Just as the right will demonize George Soros, we tend to do that. So that's absolutely brilliant. I'm wondering, so you're talking about some different strategies, and I know that some things have changed, and you had mentioned, again, back at Harvard, that some of the longtime supporters of the ACLU felt that you shouldn't be as political as you're becoming. But what I'm hearing is, you know, you're walking a fine line, because you must be nonpartisan, as must we. But you're being strategic about it, and you're looking at, well, what is the greater good? So if we are a democracy, then we should be supporting democracies. Is that one of the ways that you're...
Well, you know, I think that is such a great question, and I mean, this is what keeps me up at night, is how do we keep our balance? Mm-hmm. Because here's the pressure that I often say, you know, one of the things about the ACLU, that because we defend everybody's speech, a lot of people get upset if we represent, you know, the white supremacists and Skokie, and then other people get upset if we don't. Mm-hmm. And so I like to say, you know, if we're being equally criticized from both sides, we must have it about right. And, you know, I hope that's not a joke, can you? But that's one of our principles. Yeah. And I think that a lot of our new members since the election do not want to see us being politically neutral. They want us to be progressive, they want us to be, you know, pro-Democrat, and they want us to be supporting Democratic candidates in the election. And on my watch, we're not doing that. We're remaining nonpartisan. So I work very hard. We spend a lot of time talking about not only what we do and the choices we make about where to get involved, but in how we talk about it. Because to me, there are two things that we do in our work around voting. We have a program called the ACLU Voter. And our basic concepts are two. One is that everybody should be well-informed before they vote. Mm-hmm. So to give you one example, instead of just participating in Republican Democratic elections to try to talk about issues, we've been participating in primaries. So we were involved very much in put a heavy investment in a primary, Democratic primary for district attorney in Philadelphia. Okay, do you know how much power district attorneys have? They decide how many people go to prison, when there are going to be alternatives. They often have a lot of say in who's released on bail and who isn't. So, you know, one of our concerns about mass incarceration, you can look to be changing the laws about how people are sentenced, but you could also be looking to put people in that position of power who are going to promise to use that power in a way that is less racist. You know, who do we lock up? We lock up people who are minorities, people who are poor, people who are mentally ill. And so, you know, if you had a more enlightened person in that position, that would be great. So what we did in that election was we riled up ACLU voters, and one way that we did that, we just had a list of ACLU members in Philadelphia, and we had some formerly incarcerated people go and knock on their doors and explain to them why this was so important. You have to say, if I had been released on bail, you know, my life would have been different, or here's what happened to me. And those people got concerned, and then they got their friends and neighbors to show up at debates that the candidates were having in the Democratic primary. First of all, to just ask them questions about what's your position. And also, the other idea was that that's a point where if people are trying to get votes, and if they believe that they're going to get votes by saying, I'm opposed to cash bail, that's a point where you can get them to commit themselves to that. So people would show up at the debates and say, if I vote for you, would you commit to using your power in this way that is really much more enlightened? And as a result of that, the most progressive candidate, Lee Krasner, won the primary and ultimately became DA. And now he's doing some great things. So we're now trying to replicate that model in like 30 other cities, really just trying to inform people, educate people around the election, and use the voting power of everyone. Now, issues is great, but, you know, like the other thing that I think we are being careful of is we're not only trying to get out the Democratic voters or the progressive voters or the ACLU voters. So to me, the way I kind of keep faith with our nonpartisan principles is to say, so if there's a voter who goes to that debate and loves the fact that one of the district attorney candidates is pro-capital punishment because they love capital punishment, we also support that person's right to vote. We're not trying to swing the election. What we want is for everybody to be well-informed, make up their minds, and get out and vote. Everybody, not only the people on our side. So I don't know if that does it for you. And, but you know, that's why I think we're trying to do two things. And again, I think there are a lot of people who are disappointed if we're not just pro-democratic candidates. And in order to show that we're nonpartisan, we took out an ad to thank Justin Amash, who's a right-wing Republican. I can't remember what position he took, but he took a position that we very much agreed with. So we said, thank you. And then there was some Democratic candidate in some state who was taking a really bad position, and we took out an ad to say, won't you please change your mind on this? And there were a lot of Democratic voters in that state who were upset. But we should be supporting Democrats no matter what. Yeah, that's, we're not political.
You know, what I'm also hearing, Susan, is lifting up the personal stories. That you're having them knock on the door and tell their own personal stories. So you know that I'm going to do this because I emailed you. A personal story from you. So how did you get involved with ACLU? And clearly you're very passionate about it. So what did it for you? What brought you into it, and what holds that passion?
I'm happy to talk about that, but actually when you started to talk about stories, the thing that popped into my mind, just continuing on the theme you were talking about. So the person who is the head of, I forget what it's even called, Second Chances or something, or a campaign in Florida, not just ours, but the coalitions, is a guy named Desmond Meade. And I was just reading about his story. He's a formerly incarcerated person. And what he was saying, and I thought you would find this really interesting in terms of, again, how you get people to support that everyone should be allowed to vote. Here's what felon disenfranchisement has done, according to Desmond Meade. It's created a culture of people not voting. Because when you have a million people in Florida who can't vote, first of all, there are a lot of communities where not many people vote, so there's not a lot of interest in the elections. Second of all, what was your first awareness of voting? How many of you went to the polling place with a parent? Okay, so if your parent can't vote and they don't take you to the polling place, that's not trained. Third, if people in the community are talking about who are you going to vote for in this election, and if you can't vote and you don't want to tell them you can't vote because you were convicted of a crime, what are you going to say? You're going to say, oh, that doesn't matter, that's silly. And then that's going to build up. So in terms of the stories, the impact on people and communities of having a law like this, I think what Desmond Meade is doing is just critical to say this is not just an abstract political issue. And even if the ballot initiative wins, which it's polling very well, we expect that it will, but there's still going to be a lot of work to do in Florida to change the culture, because people have to really understand not only can you vote, but it's a desirable thing, and people have ground to make up because they're starting kind of behind the curve. So I just thought you'd like to know about that.
That's so important, because my parents took me, took all of us. Right. We went into it, and of course then you have that great thing where you close the curtain. And we love that.
People have to close the curtain.
Going to Catholic was like being in the confessional. So it's like,
Okay, so I may have told this story at Barney, this is my favorite story, but I want to tell you. So I think that when you start talking about how you become a civil libertarian or an activist or who you are, I think our values are formed when we're pretty young. So when I started to think about what was the earliest I could remember feeling passionate about anything that was like about civil liberties, what occurred to me was when I was in third grade. And our third grade class was doing a play. We did a play all the time. For some reason, the principal thought that children in plays would really charming. We have a great nephew who's 2 and a half who is starring in his daycare production of Fiddler on the Roof. He's saying, if I were a ring dog, dubba 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 dubba. But there are people who like that. So we're doing the play of Johnny Tremaine, which you may know is about a boy in the American Revolution. And I thought the story was interesting, but there aren't that many words in plays. So I went to the library and thought I'd take out the book of Johnny Tremaine and find out more about the story. So I find the book on the shelf and take it to the librarian, and she says, oh, I'm sorry, dear. When they call me dear, something's coming, you're not going to like it. She said, I'm sorry, dear, you can't take out that book. That's in the boys' section. I'm that old. I knew that there was a girls' section and a boys' section because I had been dutifully working my way through what was in the girls' section, which was collections of fairy tales and biographies of presidents' wives. Okay, so, to me that was, that was the rule, there it was. So I went home and I told my mother this. And Steve may have heard it. She was furious. Yeah, this is also about they were denying her daughter an education, so I don't know if how much of it struck her as inequality, but she just didn't like it. So she called the librarian, and a couple of days later the librarian told me that I could take out that book, and actually there was a note that I could take out whatever book I wanted, as long as my mother didn't call again. A few months later, they changed their policy.
So, to me, this is, you know, my mother was my first, you know, civil libertarian activist, and this, I think it made a very deep impression on me, that she could challenge authority. You know, they were trying to tell me who I should be and what I should read, and, you know, she got them to change that. And yeah, that's what we do. Yeah, there are things just like that. Alabama, until very recently, had, because of the ACLU, had a Christian and non-Christian section of public school libraries. Okay, they didn't want the kids reading Heather Has Two Mommies. So, you know, so you could just get, and so the ACLU wrote them a letter to say, So I want to tell you a side story. So when this came up, I told my mother, who at the time was 90-something, about this. I said, do you remember this? She said, no. You know, like, not a big deal in her life. It was what she did every day. So when I told her the story, as I remembered it, she listened very carefully and then said, good for me.
That's wonderful. It's such a wonderful reminder of how we all need to be role models.
Yeah.
And especially, you know, as I mentioned earlier, our Ethics for Children's program here is that they do look to us.
Right.
And very often, as in my children's case, their grandparents didn't live nearby. So they were looking for the members of the community to be role models for them,
yeah,
to share those stories with them and to encourage them.
Yeah, if you're talking about that, let me tell you about another woman I met who had a grandmother who was her role model. So Linda Kettner, this great woman in Charleston, South Carolina, and we were actually talking about our mothers because she had just made the difficult decision to withdraw from public life to take care of her aging mother. And that was after she had almost won election as mayor in Charleston, even though she's an out lesbian and even worse, a Democrat. So, you know, she's a really special person. So I was asking her, you know, did she get any of her values from her parents? And she said no. But she said, but I had a grandmother. So she was telling me when she was 7, or she was walking around Charleston with her grandmother, and they passed by two water fountains, and one had a label that said white, and the other had a label that said colored. And so she said to her grandmother, what's that all about? And her grandmother says, well, can you guess? And so she guessed that it had something to do with race. And her grandmother said, that's right. And Linda said, yeah, she reported it to me, but that's stupid. She said, why would anyone care what color your skin is? And her grandmother said to her, well, that's a very good question. And I hope you keep asking that question, and I hope you think a lot about the answers that you get. But right now, said her grandmother, I have a much more important question for you. What are you going to do about it? Do you love Linda Kettner's grandmother? So Linda thought about this, and she decided to drink her water from the colored water fountain. And sometime later, I'm not sure exactly how long, she was about to get on a bus in Charleston, South Carolina, and she saw that there was the colored people in the back section, so she decided to sit in the back of the bus. And the bus driver was not happy with this. He kept saying, honey, you have to move up to the front of the bus, you have to move up. And she kept saying, I can't do that, sir. And so finally, he kicked her off the bus. You know, she's like, you know, whatever she was, 8 years old, and he just puts her off the bus. So she said she got, this is like pre-cell phone. So she found her way home by just telling everybody she saw on the street her address and just relying on strangers to kind of point her in the right direction so she could walk home. But I love that story. That not just, you know, what do you think, but what are you going to do about it?
The courage of an 8-year-old.
Yeah, of an 8-year-old. Right. And that, you know, it trained her. She's a lifelong activist now. A great book. But I think that's so much what you're saying, Anne, the engagement.
Exactly. And to support that when our children do it.
Yeah.
Support it.
Oh, exactly.
I have other questions, but I suspect that you do as well. So I think we have a wireless mic someplace, and I'm wondering, Amy and Maggie, could you get the wireless mic? And if you have a question, please raise your hand high. Okay, Janet? Okay, maybe we don't have it, but boom it out and we'll repeat it.
Sorry, it's a basic question. I'm a member of the ACLU and I'm following on Facebook every day when the number keeps going up for the separation since the what are the consequences? Is there any, I know you're working hard. First of all, thank you for being on the ground where you are to try to reunite the family. But are there any consequences for breaching what they judge?
Are there consequences? The question is about the family separation cases and what the consequences are for, you know, not, you know, for the method of compliance with the court order. These cases to me are so heartbreaking. You know, like, just when you thought you couldn't get any worse. So if you're not that familiar with the work, our first client in these cases was a woman who's called in the literature Ms. L, and she's from Democratic Republic of Congo, which is the poorest nation on the face of the planet. And she somehow, you know, it's also, you know, they're not in civil war, but there's a lot of violence, and it's a terrible place to live.
So somehow, I don't know all the stories behind this, but she got herself and her six-year-old daughter to San Diego. And if you can imagine, you know, who knows how she came up with the resources or, you know, got to do that. And at that point, she did what you're supposed to do. She did not enter the country illegal. She applied for asylum. And so what you do then is you ask a border official, the first person you come across, you tell them that you're applying for asylum, and you tell them what you're a refugee from. And so she explained the circumstances, and the border agent gave her the ruling of the plausible case. Yeah, that, yeah, and we're going to look into this. Yes, you've stated a good claim, and so you may be eligible for refugee status for asylum. So she does that, and while pending the disposition of her claim, they lock her up in San Diego, and they lock up her six-year-old daughter in Chicago. This little girl had her seventh birthday in detention. So to me, one of the most touching things, you know, you're talking about the people who are not yet reunited, but to see Ms. L and her little daughter reunited, you know, if you can do that for one family, yeah. What are the consequences? Well, the consequences for the families of both are horrendous. Yeah, anyone here a psychologist? Yeah, you know, it's just, you know, it's horrendous to separate children that young from their parents. And then we've heard heartbreaking stories of children who are reunited with their parents and won't go to them because they think their parents have abandoned them, and therefore they think they need to make a different choice. So as Anne was saying, Lee Learnt, who had been with the ACLU for like 25 years, and he had kept his head very low, and then he was the one who won the first injunction against the Muslim ban. Remember that great night in Brooklyn, and then he had to, much against his will, he had to get on Twitter. But yeah, everybody wanted to follow him, and he was a guest on Samantha Bee and all this.
He's
a movie star. He's always been a rock star, but he was a very quiet rock star. But so yeah, he's actually now in Guatemala trying to physically, because you know that's what the Trump administration said. Well, you want to reunite families? Okay, you do it. So, you know, I don't know that we're going to get a court to hold anyone in contempt of court for what's happening, because if they really downright disobey a court order, you know, that's one thing. They're trying to get the consent decree under which they're limited in how long they can detain a child, you know, vacated. So, you know, have they been disobeying the law? Yes, I think they have. But, you know, it's really difficult to look at what a court might do.
Well, they're trying to get around the Flores Agreement, right? They're trying to do that and incarcerate, not sort of separate them, have them together. I mean, they're doing all kinds of things around the Flores Agreement.
Yeah. And it's clear that all this is just like the Muslim ban. They're just trying to keep people from coming into the country, unless they're from non-shithole countries like Norway.
Yeah, question, please, yeah.
I'd like to know the status in New York of the two legislative issues that you discussed, because I have the ear of my state assembly and senator and my city councilman, and I'll see them this Thursday, and I might be able to present something to them and have some written information.
That is fabulous. Okay, welcome to People Power. Yeah, the ACLU does 14 different areas, right? Yesterday I was talking about the First Amendment, 2 days before that I was talking about voting rights. You know, I don't have enough brain cells for all the details, but what I would invite you to do is go on ACLU.org, People Power, and look up New York. Okay, and that's going to have the exact legislation, and it should have what the status is. But I think that, you know, if you're talking to people who are involved in New York legislation, they'll know about this. There are pending bills, and these are very live issues. Too late, obviously, for this election. But it's really important stuff to just try to open up the vote, even in New York. So yeah, again, you can get an exact answer to that question by going to peoplepower.org, and when you get to the Voting Rights Initiative, just click on New York. Okay, and thank you, and welcome to the fight. I just feel like at the end of Casablanca, you know, welcome back to the fight. Right?
Statements around the different issues. One of them you mentioned earlier was mental health and how important it is to respect and really be mindful about how policies affect people living with mental illness or mental health. One of the policies around gun safety talked about the dangers of when you have universal background checks, there's going to be categories that people bring out. So not necessarily, I don't want to get into weeds about the dangers of universal background checks, because we might disagree on policies there, but maybe you could speak specifically around the dangers of people with mental health issues, which maybe one out of four of us. And if we have a category where people with mental illness have difficulty keeping or getting guns, that could affect their safety. So they'd be scared to talk to doctors about if they're feeling down or blue or suicidal.
Okay, so there's an old joke that you probably have never heard, but it's one that goes around in our circles, is how does a civil libertarian count to 10? 1, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so a lot of people don't, conservatives all accuse us of not respecting the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms, the same way we respect the First Amendment. So we're not the NRA. We certainly don't support that everyone has a right to bear arms, and that means you can't have reasonable gun control regulations. So we do think that there can certainly be reasonable gun control regulations, but at the parkland, we were very concerned about the proposal of, well, just keep guns out of the hands of anybody who's mentally ill. Because as you know, that's an incredibly elastic category. I mean, if anybody who's ever had an incident of depression can't own a gun, and if you don't own a gun in Oklahoma, who are you? It's a real identity issue for a lot of people. So we didn't like that legislation. And we have gun control people who weren't all happy with us because they just want more, limitations on guns. The other thing that we didn't like that everyone else thought was a no-brainer was let's just deny guns to everybody who's on the no-fly lists. But the no-fly lists are based on garbage in, garbage out. There's a whole lot of people who are Muslims who really kept, who even knows that they got to be on the no-fly list. So there were a number of individual pieces of gun control legislation that we really were not supportive of. And again, everyone's mad at us. The right-wing people are mad at us that we're not supporting the right to bear arms enough. And the gun control people are mad at us that we're not supporting all the legislation possible. So I'll tell you, our main role in the Parkland incident is we've been totally supporting the kids organizing for gun regulation. And before they had that big march with everybody staying out of school and all, we had a Know Your Rights video that went around on Twitter and on social media that had well over a million hits of all the kids, and everyone was looking at this. And the ACLU affiliates also did a lot representing kids who then have trouble with their school if they walk out and the schools are retaliating against them. So we've had a lot to do about the organizing around gun control, but less directly on gun control because we're not the pro-Second Amendment, we're not the NRA, but we're also not totally in the other direction.
Thank you. I think we have time for one more. Kevin?
So one of the things I love about the ACLU is that you do things that on principle and not because. Because one of the things I hate about the current political people is that if it's, if whether it's right or wrong, if it's my party, I'll vote for it or whatever. So one of the places where I sort of party company, well, it's about Citizens United, and so I had a talk with Steve Shapiro. I go to the gym with Steve.
Former legal director of the ACLU.
Yeah, he and I go to the gym together. Anyway, and he told me that, well, Citizens United is a First Amendment, and we're behind the First Amendment. Is the ACLU still standing?
Yes, we are. And the basic idea, I think a lot of people demonize Citizens United and think that it's to blame for the fact that money has an influence on politics. Well, money has an influence on politics because some people have it and some people don't. And the greater influence by far than corporations is individuals, brothers and other people. So the reason that we don't really buy the Citizens United line is that the ACLU is a corporation. And if you can say to the ACLU, you cannot take out an issues ad before an election saying, please tell President Trump not to support, not to separate families, or not to demonize transgender people. That is a First Amendment issue. We support reasonable limits on campaign contributions. But we think that to say to anybody, you cannot publish an ad within this amount of time of the election or whatever it is, or even to single out corporations. There are some corporations that are doing very right-wing things, and there are some corporations that are Ben and Jerry's. Right, that want to sort of promote different values. And we're kind of all for more speech. But I think this is a great last question, Kathleen, what you were saying about nonpartisan, is that this is a place where, going back to the theme of keeping our balance, a lot of our new members, I think, are highly shocked at the idea that we might also represent a Trump organization and their free speech rights, because we really do try to be content neutral.
But the problem for us these days, and one thing we're talking about a lot internally, which I think gets back to your first question, Anne, is the whole question of how do you even be nonpartisan these days when the White House is a black hole for civil liberties? You know, when the Republican Party is trying, and they're watched right now. Last term, there were two cases in the Supreme Court about political gerrymandering. One was the Republicans in Wisconsin, and the other was the Democrats in Maryland. And we were anti-partisan gerrymandering in both cases, because it's the principle. And I don't want to see us lose our soul. And to me, our soul is nonpartisan. And we have to continue to be fighting whichever party does it. And we have to be continuing to represent anybody's speech. And again, not everybody is happy with that. But what I see us as, and where I see us as special, you know, I've had a very good friend who I said to us at dinner the other night, but we're involved in a civil war. How can you be taking that position? How can you spend any resources at all representing the other side's right to speech? And where I think that that's very short-sighted is I think the major problem that we have, our major threat right now, is that we're so divided, this hyper-partisanship where everyone, I saw a cartoon a few weeks ago about TV meteorologists saying, and now the weather for Republicans. Isn't that what it feels like? It's like everybody has a different truth and nobody can agree on anything. And I've been, one of the things I've been thinking about that I'm trying to include in my speeches these days is to get back to the Constitution, where the people who wrote the Constitution couldn't agree on anything. There were the Federalists and the Anti-Federalists and the slavery people and the abolitionists, and they just couldn't agree on what the results should be. But what they managed to agree on was a fair process for making those decisions. They said we have to have neutral election rules, we have to have free speech for everybody, we have to have everybody has an equal chance to participate and get their view heard, and then we'll vote and we'll see. You know, some states will say okay to slavery and some will say not okay. But that whole idea that we should be able to agree on fundamental principles is to me what we have to do now. I mean, sure, you're all fighting in the next election to get, you know, people who agree with better results to be elected. But long range, I don't think that's a winning strategy for having a democracy or having a country. I think long range, we have to, and this is my, you know, charge to you. You know, don't only hang out with people who agree with you. You know, take on the relative of Thanksgiving dinner who totally disagrees with you. And don't just yell at each other or say, I'm right because, or try to throw facts in their face which they're going to reject. Try to find your common ground. You know, try to find, are there still fundamental principles that we all can agree on?
Wonderful. I'm so glad you've given them a charge, because I like to always end whatever platform I give with marching orders. So you've done that so well. And I really appreciate you coming here for a conversation. I know that you're giving speeches all over the place, but I hope that having a conversation with us was
Oh, I so much appreciate the suggestion. And Anne says to say to me, you know, I know you give speeches all the time. Would you like to just have a conversation? I said, sure.
Good.
So this is great. Thank you so much for inviting me.
Thank you very much.